coming back to Kyiv, we do have in our studio Vyacheslav Lihachev, who is the head of the National Minority Rights Monitoring Group, and he's an expert from Eurasian Jewish Congress, residing in Israel but working a lot in Ukraine and in the region with different human rights organizations, with the Jewish Congress, and many, many, many more, speaking a lot about what's happening now. So the topic we probably would touch a few. It's also this monitoring of the minority rights in Ukraine, but also that you're writing a lot and explaining a lot about all the far rights in Ukraine, which was a very, very you know, hot topic in the foreign media. But you're an expert. You're somebody who counts, who knows, who has an who have an expertise. So you've recently written a piece on Ukrainian and Russian volunteer far rights in Russian-Ukrainian war. And so what would be your major, you know, stake on that, if you would explain it to those who don't know to that level?
Good evening. First of all, of course, it's natural that far rights were involved in a Russian-Ukrainian war from the both sides. And it's also true that the Ukrainian part was more in focus of foreign media and foreign politicians, partly because in Ukraine it is also in agenda in a national media. In Ukraine there are independent national media. In Ukraine there is a civil society which pay attention to this question. So it was in agenda also of international media speaking about Ukraine. Second, Ukraine tried to be or pretend to be a part of European society with European standards of what is human rights, what is rights of minorities, and for from point of view of European society, it's strange when neo-Nazi groups with open far-right rhetoric and symbols became an official battalion or other military groups in frames of Ministry of Interior or Ministry of Defense. That's a little bit strange. But actually, from my point of view, in a real military action, the role of Russian neo-Nazi and far-right groups in Donbas were much more important, partly because the role of volunteers, or so-called volunteers, is much more important on the Donbas pro-Russian side. The Russian openly military involved was only in several moments. And I mean, you have far-right groups were, from the very beginning, the core of the so-called separatist military forces.
And I mean, since coming from Israel, and there are these groups talked about much? I mean, is there discussion about these far-right groups or concern or for the Jewish community?
Yes, of course. In Israel, it's the most important subject is their situation with Jewish community. Jews are really in danger because neo-Nazi have weapons with their anti-Semitic rhetoric. They openly used, so it is in focus. But from the very beginning, it was much more attention because it was a fear about this situation. Now there is an understanding that Jews are not part of the conflict. They are not on agenda of the conflict, and there is a rise of repatriation, aliyah from Ukraine to Israel, but it is not because of danger of anti-Semitism, but just because of the general situation.
And Vyacheslav, you write a lot about the myth, and what in this case, there is a lot of speculation on anything connected, and anti-Semitism, that's the card the Russia plays, but at the same time, there is sometimes the denial to discuss also from the, you know, some Ukrainian government officials or even the Ukrainian society, and if not to speak about the myth, but about the reality, what would be your assessment of the, you know, what would be the problem, what would be the issue to watch out and focus?
Yes, really, there are two sides of the discussion. From the one side, from Russian official propaganda, from pro-Russian analytical and semi-human rights groups which are supported by Kremlin, also international ones, there is a lot of speeches about danger of anti-Semitism, rise of anti-Semitism, dangers for the Jews in Ukraine. And from the other hand, there is a reaction of Ukrainian officials and the Ukrainian society, and sometimes from the Ukrainian Jewish community, that there is no anti-Semitism at all in Ukraine. And the truth, as always, is between. We provide a monitoring of hate crimes, including anti-Semitic ones. And what we can see is that there is some level of hate crimes as in other Eastern European countries. The general situation with anti-Semitism for different reasons is much more better than in Western European countries. And there is, what is important to stress, there is no rise of anti-Semitic violence, hate crimes during revolution and during the war from the for last two years.
I mean, what I hear from what you're saying is that Ukraine is similar to other countries in terms of the far right and in terms of hate crimes. Is there anything exceptional about Ukraine when it comes to right-wing groups? Because sometimes in Ukraine, you know, this is my subjective experience, right-wing groups are trusted to get things done in a more serious way than other parties. Is that something reflected at all in the research you've done?
Well, the situation is complicated because from the one hand, there are really a number of radical right groups with very clear and open neo-Nazi rhetoric with symbols of Nazi German times. And from the other hand, till now, for last year and a half, they have a real enemy. They have a situation of the real war. So they have a totally different agenda than radical rights in Europe or all over the world have. They don't need to find enemy on the streets of the Ukrainian cities because they have a real military enemy and a real possibility to struggle for the Ukrainian national ideas that they understand on a front line. So from the one hand, there is we really think that Ukrainian far-right groups and their rhetoric became more legitimized in eyes of society. But from the other hand, we can see that their agenda and what is important for them right now is a totally changed from their agenda 2 or 3 years ago.
And in general, during the whole this time of the conflict, you were in different of the publication. You were raising the issue of the hate speech. Of you know, it's always during the time of the wars, the society is really probably becoming sometimes aggressive, sometimes very traumatized. But also that would be the issue in the Ukrainian media. I mean, we know not speaking now about the Russian media, because there is a huge, you know, anyways, it's a two different realities wherever you think about the one or the other. So what would be your assessment now? Has things has changed? Sometimes you kind of raised in the awareness. What should be we also worry now, or shouldn't we?
Well, what was in the focus of our monitoring is hate speech against ethnic minorities. So it is a little bit different than hate speeches between two sides of the conflict. But from the very beginning of the conflict, it was a fear that there Russian speakings or IDPs from the Eastern regions, they will face a xenophobic reaction in media, in social networks, and so it has an influence to the mass mentality. But now, as far as we see, the wave of such kind hate speeches was not so big, and it maximum was in the middle of the previous year, in the very beginning of the conflict, when it was not clear will the conflict stop in the eastern region or will be next some other cities or regions of the conflict. And I think that till now the situation, of course, it is dangerous, but it is not very horrible.
All right. Well, we'll continue to watch that situation. Thank you so much for joining us.